Many of them are logging in, but we'll start off. It's already 4, no? Stick to the time.
Yes.
Good evening to all the construction professionals who have logged in, and good evening, sir, for having accepted our invitation and to be the speaker of the day. We have Dr. R. Nagendra, who would be talking to us today on a very important topic, proportioning of concrete mixes from a durability point of view. In fact, durability is one of those things which we have not been concentrating or testing. In fact, there are various things for checking the durability of concrete. So that is a very important topic and a very recent one. Many of the consultants and construction projects are also going in for checking the durability of concrete. So Dr. Nagendra is presently the senior director at Mrs. Stetron Technology in Bangalore. Earlier, he was with Civil Aid Technologies, which later on became Bureau Veritas India Limited. And he is an empaneled NABL auditor member, and he is the member of CED2, Committee of Bureau of Indian Standards, New Delhi, and members of some committee relating to preparation of standards. So he's a life member of the Indian Concrete Institute, Association of Consulting Civil Engineers, Indian Institute of Engineers, Indian Society of Technical and Chartered Engineers. His field of interest is in testing of building and highway materials as per BIS, ASTM, British standards, EN standards, and MORT standards. So special test on new construction materials and structural systems. Test on repair materials, design of normal concrete mixes, high performance concrete, high volume fly ash concrete, self-compacting concrete, high ready-mix concrete certification, non-destructive testing, precast concrete products, green building materials, and the list is endless. Everything related to concrete is what Dr. Nagendra is dealing with. So we are indeed privileged to have you as the speaker of the day, sir. And just a brief about Ramco Cements, our recent initiatives. My name is Anil Kumar Pillai, and I am the General Manager of Technical Services Division of Ramco. In fact, our recent initiative has been with reference to the right product for right application, because you know, you cannot have one type of cement for all type of concrete work. So it's very important that we understand the concrete that is required at various sites, and then recommend for the cement that is required for the specific work. So keeping that in mind, we have 12 cement products, in fact 12 cement brands, that is 4 brands within Portland Pozzolana Cement, 2 brand within Portland Slag Cement. So based on the concrete requirement, we would be able to specify the cement for the particular concrete. Apart from that, we also have ordinary Portland cement, OPC 43 and OPC 53. Within OPC 53, we have OPC 53 infra. In fact, OPC 53 infra is meant for specifically for those concrete works which need high slump retention, because there is a demand for high slump retention concrete for various works. So keeping that in mind, OPC 53 infra has been made. And apart from that, we have a cement specifically for precast products. We have cement for precast products, which is Ramco Superfast. And we have sulfate resistant Portland cement. So that is the range of products that we have as far as cement is concerned. Apart from that, we have dry mix range of products, which is the tile fix, super plaster, rock fix, self-curing plaster, super fine, and tile grout. So these are the range of products that we have for the non-structural application. So this is what we have got as far as cement as well as products for non-structural application is concerned. Apart from that, we have experience in interacting with various construction professionals, you know, ranging from individual householders to major projects and institutions. Like say, for example, the metro is a major institution with whom we have been dealing with. ITD Cementation, Larsen & Toubro, Soma Enterprise, Delhi Buildcon, Ashok Buildcon, NCC, Gammon, Tata Housing. So these institutions have the expertise in making different concrete for different construction. So, you know, when we interact with this personnel of various construction companies, we are able to understand the diversity as far as concrete is concerned, because concrete cannot be uniform. Based on the site, based on the construction material, based on the requirement, based on the site conditions, many of the concrete mix design changes, because you need to look at the transportation of concrete, how much time it is going to be transported. So this has given us a wide exposure, and we have been able to amalgamate all that through our Ramco Research Development Center, where we conduct regular tests on cement as well as concrete. In fact, we have a lot of tests for designing, for evaluating the durability of concrete, and for conducting various tests using the latest equipment on cement. Say, for example, the X-ray diffractometer and things like that. And we have the mercury intrusion porosimeter to study the particle size distribution of cement in detail. So that is the kind of technology that we have got at our Ramco Research Development Center. And we have also been the recipient of the Four Leaves Award, which has been given to us for leadership in technology, energy efficiency, and for utilizing blending material in concrete. So that is one thing which we have been given, and that's it about Ramco Cements. And as we go on, I would be sharing. So just a brief overview of the forthcoming webinars. Tomorrow at 10:30, we have a webinar on modern construction practices by Dr. Shashi Shankar. And thereafter, we have a panel discussion on RMC, which would be notified to you shortly. And after that, May 3rd, we have a webinar on ferrocement and its application by Dr. Ganeshan, who was with NIT earlier. So these are some of the forthcoming webinars. May 5th, we have fixed one on sustainable construction. This is the 10th webinar that we are having with Dr. Nagendra as speaker. And I am sure that he would be able to throw more light on durable construction. So over to you, sir. You can start. I have stopped sharing my screen. You can start enabling the share content.
Hello, good evening.
Good evening, sir.
Thank you very much, Mr. Anil Pillai, for the nice introduction. First, let me upload the presentation.
Sure. Take your time, sir, for uploading. It's visible. You can put that slideshow also.
Yeah.
Is it? Oh, it's perfect. Perfect.
Good evening, everybody. Good evening. It's a pleasure to be with you all during this COVID-19 lockdown, which is going on quite a prolonged time. And we are in another way, we are very happy. Many webinars are being arranged, and this time Ramco and ACCE Bangalore Center has come together to organize this type of webinars, series of webinars. And I first of all, let me thank the organizers for giving me an opportunity to share whatever the knowledge and I have acquired over the years, and also would like to always interact with you, gain more experience, taking this as a very good opportunity. So first of all, I would like to speak about the another organization which we are holding this particular webinar. Association of Consulting Civil Engineers Bangalore Center welcome all the participants to this webinar. Mr. Rajesh Kannan, chairman, Srikant Channal, secretary, and Savina Kumar, treasurer, welcomes you to this webinar on proportioning of concrete mixes from durability point of view. Association of Consulting Civil Engineers was formed, registered in 1985 by a group of consulting civil engineers, Bangalore. The main object of the association is to encourage and foster the ideals of profession, to hold conferences, meetings, seminars for dissemination of knowledge amongst the civil engineers in particular and society at large. So there are many quite a few programs which are being organized by association to bring to the members the latest technological advancements to the fraternity, prepare them to carry out futuristic designs with an eye on assurance of quality, to give access to technical papers, books, and computer software, to arrange lectures by distinguished engineers from India and abroad, conduct study tour of projects, to act as a spokesman for the consultants to deal with government, corporations, and other agencies regarding policy matters. ACC Bangalore Center is very active in this particular aspect of interacting with the government to identify the areas in which consultants can contribute to the betterment of the country, like rural housing, urban development, low cost housing, etc. So with this introduction, let me give a brief, very few information about my company where I am working, Stadran Techno Clinic Private Limited, which was formed in 2017 by a group of engineers who have worked 35 years with Tar Steel Research Foundation in India, Civil Air Techno Clinic Private Limited, and Bureau Veritas India Private Limited, in various capacities as senior directors executing various challenging assignments in their field of specialization. STPL has its head office in Bangalore and a division office at Hyderabad. And our activities include proof checking of designs and advisory services, laboratory testing of construction materials, components and special tests, structural soundness and evaluation of old and new structures, geotechnical investigations and foundation designs, non-destructive testing of RC and steel structures, quality assurance and quality audit of constructions, and structural designs and consultancy services. These are our areas, and this is our enable certification, enable accreditation in the field of mechanical, chemical, and NDT. So with this introduction of the companies, with the introduction of the organizations involved in this particular webinar, let me start my topic of discussion, proportion of concrete mixes from the durability point of view. See, proportioning of concrete mixes always is done by a particular method. It can be Indian standard method, or it can be American Concrete Institute method, or any other method. As far as civil engineers are concerned, in respect of concrete making, we always refer to what is called as IS 456, our important standard, like a Bible for civil engineers, and IS 10262, which has seen the second revision very recently in 2019. As all of you know, concrete is a porous material. As it is a porous material, because we are making many material which are not really making homogeneous, making into a homogeneous material, thereby porosity comes inherently with the concrete. So as there is porosity, diffusion of gases, water, dissolved agents make the concrete to lose its durability, or durability can be a concern if the concrete mixes are not proportioned properly. So like this, you need to understand, when you are making the proportion of the concrete mixes, what are the aggressive chemicals, what are the diffusion takes place in terms of water, chlorides, sulfates. So all these things matter, and also how much care we have taken while making the concrete and while proportioning the concrete mixes. So this is a flow chart which gives the various details. And another thing which I want to explain, in addition to the diffusion of various external agencies or external elements, external compounds into the concrete, we have what is called hydration of cement, which results in volume change. So volume change also results in many things. It can be expansion, it can be shrinkage. So this is how the concrete undergoes and affects the durability of concrete. So durability of concrete has to be looked at from two perspectives. One is the concrete system, which consists of the materials used for making the concrete. And the other side, we have the processes, like how do you mix the concrete, how do you transport the concrete, how are you going to do the compaction, whether it is a normal concrete, normal vibrated concrete, or whether it is self-compacted concrete, what are the methods of curing which are adopted at site, then the temperature in which the concrete is poured, and also that the quantity of cement contained, thereby the heat of hydration. So all these issues, and also the workmanship matters a lot. So materials and process forms the concrete system. And of course, as already discussed, there are aggressiveness of the environment through physical actions and also chemical actions. Physical actions includes abrasion, erosion, cavitation, freeze and thaw, which is normally found in Western countries or the countries where it's a cold climate is there. And of course, again, the chemical dissolution, leaching, expansion, alteration. So this is how the durability has to be looked at from the two perspective. One is concrete system, another is aggressiveness of the environment. So as we know, the concrete being from a very simple cement, aggregate, water system has moved into a very complicated system in order to make things achieve many milestones, things. The concrete has added so many things into it. That means concrete is being made with so many ingredients. So these ingredients are listed here. You know very well pozzolanic materials, fly ash, you have hydraulic material, GGBS, and also in addition to these two, again from the same fly ash and the GGBS, nowadays we have what is called as ultrafine materials, which is we can call it as ultrafine GGBS or very fine pulverized fuel ash. So microsilica, metakaolin, these are also the ultrafine materials which are added to the concrete to achieve certain special properties. Then coming to another important ingredient of concrete, fine aggregate, which is made from crushed stone from a VSI crusher, because I want to emphasize on this particular aspect. When you want to make a durable concrete, you need to look into how you are producing the aggregate. Then coarse aggregate again from a VSI crusher, because we want to really have a concrete which is more dense, which has got more particle packing. And another important construction material, that is water, mixing water. Water which we use to mix the concrete should be of construction quality. As per IS 456, we need to take care of the quality of water. Unless the quality of water is good, it won't be possible for us to make a good concrete. Otherwise, it will have its own effect in the hardened stage. Then chemical admixtures in terms of superplasticizers or hyperplasticizers have made wonders, and because of which only we are able to pump the concrete to such a higher heights. It can be Burj Dubai or any tall structure in the world would not have been possible without the use of superplasticizers or hyperplasticizers. So they have become part and parcel and a very important constituent of concrete. And of course, there are many other things like fibers which are added to the concrete to make the concrete more and more shrinkage resistant, and also to have more toughness. So different factors affect the consistency and compactability of the concrete mix are: water increases the flowability but reduces the strength. Binder increases the need for water. When you use fly ash and GGBS, the water demand increases. The round aggregate shapes improve compatibility, reduce tensile strength. Then an optimal grading curves improve compactability. That means we need to have very good size and shape of the aggregates. A good optimal grading curve is very much essential. So plasticizers reduce water demand, most important. As you use more and less water, the concrete quality improves, the concrete strength improves, durability of the concrete improves. An increase in temperature or delay in casting reduces compactability. So location of the structure to be classified as mild, moderate, severe, because this becomes the starting point for any concrete mix design. So this we need to look into IS 456 provisions, which are as mild, moderate, severe, very severe, and extreme. Wherever the structure is being built, at that point, we will be making use of, we'll be selecting to which exposure condition that particular structure falls into, whether it is a mild exposure, moderate exposure, severe exposure, or very severe exposure, or extreme exposure. Once you decide this to which category you are designing the concrete mix, then the many things fall into line. Of course, the durability has been addressed in IS 456 way back in 2000 itself. They have made the stipulations for the minimum grade of concrete for various exposure conditions, What should be the minimum grade? Like M20 is a minimum grade for any RCC works, but similarly for moderate and severe exposure conditions, the grade, minimum grade of concrete has been fixed. Also, the maximum water cement ratio and the minimum cement content decides again based on the, is decided based on the exposure condition. So the exposure decides the minimum grade to be adopted, maximum water cement ratio and the minimum cement content, or it, you can call it as minimum cementitious content, because it is not cement alone, it is a cementitious content which concrete mixes. So like this, for very severe and extreme conditions also, we have this table from IS-456, which we'll be making use while proportioning the concrete mix. One more thing, of course, we select the cement or cementitious material based on the exposure condition, but also you need to look at the aggregate volume, how much aggregate volume has to be there in 1 cubic meter of concrete. This minimizes the volumes of cement and other things, paste in general. So if you have a good packing of aggregates, then of course your paste requirement reduces. If the paste is less, then naturally the shrinkage and other side effects will be reduced to a very considerable extent. So it is always advisable to use for a given set of constituents of concrete as less paste as possible. Similar, paste is actually cement plus cementitious material plus water. So remember that aggregate is natural, and the variation in quality and properties is larger in comparison to cement and other components. So in a QC lab, emphasis should be given for the aggregate, understanding the aggregate properties, and also making finding out its size and shape of the aggregates. So you can see the difference between aggregates from a jaw crusher, which are flaky and elongated, that if it is from a VSA crusher, the aggregate shape is much better. They will be towards the cubical shape, or you can say the angular shape, not irregular, I can say angular or cubical, which will have a very good packing when you proportion the concrete mixes. So this is the packing density which we need to look into. As much packing density is always good. Voids should be very less. If you can pack both coarse and fine aggregates by selecting suitable proportions of coarse and fine aggregates in the total aggregate content, you will be achieving a higher packing density, which will result in lower paste content. So after cement, cementitious material and aggregates, another important thing is the use of superplasticizers or chemical admixtures. So here again, how you can see the water demand, how it reduces when you use superplasticizer. So superplasticizer is basically water reducing admixture, wherein you can, without compromising on the workability requirements, you can achieve a good workable mix, a cohesive mix, and at the same time, a higher strength than what you would have achieved with the higher water content, which we would have used normally if you do not use a superplasticizer. So like this, the compressive strength again depends upon what type of curing, what type of admixture you use, whether it is retarded or any reference, and any accelerated admixtures you use. We don't use normally accelerated admixtures in this case. Only in precast constructions we may go for accelerated admixtures. So this gives an indication as the how compressive strength can be developed when you use different type of chemical admixtures. So this is again another, as the testing gauge increases, how we can improve the compressive strength by various combinations of rapid hardening cement, micro silica, fly ash combinations and all. So there are n number of permutations combinations you can make while proportioning the concrete mixes to achieve the end result. Now 10262, as I told you, IS 10262, which is the second revision which has come very recently in 2019, has resulted in much variations. But at the same time, whatever we have been talking about for quite a long time, use of self-compacting concrete, or use of fly ash and GGBS in the concrete mix proportioning, these things have been incorporated or included in the mix, in the examples given in this particular standard 10262, because earlier people were a bit skeptical in using these cementitious materials when the first revision was there, even though there was one particular example given in that one. Now this standard addresses the use of cementitious materials such as fly ash and GGBS to whatever the permissible values are there, even though the examples may show you 30% or 40% of replacement. But the industry has moved much forward by incorporating this cementitious material in the concrete mixers in a big way, to the tune of about up to 70% of GGBS or even up to 50% of fly ash in the mixers. So this particular code itself, the title or the heading is guidelines. Guidelines is it's not mandatory. Frankly speaking, it only gives you the guideline. Guideline is something, you know, you read, understand, and try to follow on the similar lines, but you can have your own formula, your own way of proportioning the concrete mix, but end result of achieving the required workability and the strength. In addition to these two, now whatever we are talking today, that's on durability. Durability aspects are also required to be achieved in whatever method you follow. So IS 10262-2019 has five sections, section 1, section 2, section 3, section 4, incorporating the details about general, then ordinary and standard grades of concrete, high strength grades of concrete, and self-compacting concrete, mass concrete, things like this. So the combination of 456 and 10262 classifies ordinary concrete as M10, M15, and M20, and standard concretes are M25 to M55. And high strength concretes are M60 to M100. So this is how you can classify the grades of concrete. And this is another addition into IS 10262, which was not there in the earlier code, because there was not much data available for various grades of cement. Based on the cement grades, whether we can have a relation between free water cement ratio and then 28 day compressive strength. So this has been included in this particular code. This particular graph was there in the very old 10262 of 1982. And again, it has come back with more and more practical data. And this will be very useful, which gives a starting point to decide the water cement ratio to be adopted for the various grades of concrete. Another aspect is there are two ways of determining the target strength of the mix proportioning. Target strength is something which we aim at in the laboratory while designing a concrete mix, taking into account of the variations in the cube strength by way of calculating the standard deviation. Standard deviation, for calculating standard deviation, we need to have at least about 30 cube strength. So this 30 cube, unless these 30 cube results are obtained, or you can say if you do not have 30 cube test results, again 456 as well as 10262 gives a guideline to what standard deviation you can adopt. But here there is one more factor called factor based on the grade of concrete, X factor. So you can use this also, but I have found that if you use this from the table, I think if I'm correct, these are the values of X given in IS 10262, or if you go for the standard deviation values given in the code, normally standard deviation values are only more than, because the greater of the two you have to select, whichever is greater you have to select. So that's why we don't use this value of X, only we are going by standard deviation. And if you have your own standard deviation, you can use that for calculating the target strength. Another thing which has come into 10262-2019 is air content, which was missing in the previous first revision. Now this has come back in this revision of 10262. There will be some entrapped air, whatever may be the compaction you do, entrapped air will be present, which depends upon the maximum size of the aggregate you are using, whether 10 mm, 20 mm, 40 mm. You have to use this entrapped air percentage in the mixed design calculations. Otherwise, there is nothing much importance to this. It makes change when you are making the concrete to the tune of 1,000 cubic meter of concrete, 100 cubic meters of concrete. Air content really matters because the volumes, the calculations will decide how much output, how much yield of the concrete we are getting for a particular recipe of the concrete mix. You need to refer to this table also, depending upon what type of workability you need for various types of placing conditions, whether you are placing the mass concrete, or whether you are doing a heavily reinforced sections, or whether it is a slip form work, or whether it is a trench concrete where you need a high slump like this. So normally we go for 75 to 100 mm input concrete, or depending upon nowadays, there are many, many requirements. If it is a MI1 shuttering, the requirements are different. The self-compacting concrete requirements are different. That is not addressed in this particular table. So process of concrete mix design includes three stages. I make use of any method, 10262 or your experience to arrive at an initial estimate, to start the trials, then go for the small scale trials in the laboratory, wherein you will get a fair idea whether you are achieving the required slump or not. You need to modify the proportions of coarse and fine aggregates, or increase or decrease the cement content, or the super plasticizer, the type, as well as the volume, the content, the percentage, what you are adding, dosage, I can say. Dosage needs to be changed to achieve the required values. Once you are satisfied with the laboratory results, both in terms of workability as well as in terms of strength, you have to carry out the full scale trials at the construction site. It can be a site batching plant, or it can be RMC plant. RMC plant, regularly they carry out the mixed design trials in their laboratories. Nowadays, most of the RMC plants have got very good laboratory facilities. In the batching plants, wherever they do not have facility, they take the mixed design from the third party laboratory and carry out the full scale trials. While carrying out the full scale trials, there may be a requirement to make few more modifications so that you will be able to realize whatever it has been decided in the laboratory at site also. So now, one thing which we have noticed is in our laboratory, whatever the mixer we use, wherein we can use only a small quantity of concrete. When you use a small quantity of concrete, the workability, what you get, and also when you do the full scale trials, wherein the efficiency of the mixer is very good. Nowadays, we have twin shaft rotating blades, their efficiency is really very good. We get sometimes more slump also at the batching plants or the RMC plants. Thereby, they can still modify the mix design to meet the particular needs. So these three important stages are to be taken. And it is always advisable to carry out, it is compulsory, I can say, using the materials which are actually used at the site. Otherwise, if you send some material, if you use some material, send some material to the laboratory, and if you do the mix design, it will not match the actual materials performance in the site. So this is a very important thing. And what are the data you need while proposing the concrete mixes? As already we discussed, the exposure condition, what grade of concrete you are using, and sometimes the maximum water cement ratio as per IS 456. And the minimum cement content, you need to take it from the same IS 456 only. What type of cement you are using, whether it is OPC, PPC, PSC, or any other rapid hardening cement or something like that. Then the maximum size of aggregate you are using, whether it is 12.5, 20 or 40, depending upon whether it's a normal concrete or self-compacting concrete, or even it is a mass concrete. So size of aggregate may change. Minimum cement content, maximum water cement ratio, and degree of workability. These also to be decided before you start the mix design. Then maximum temperature of concrete at the time of placing. This is an important aspect. You need to account this, especially in the hot climatic areas, the aggregate would have got very high temperature. Or depending upon the mix proportion, if the cement content is very high, you have to consider the addition of cementitious materials such as fly ash and GGBS. Early age strength requirements, if any, sometimes some people expect, especially in precast concrete, 12-hour strength, 14-hour strength, or 10-hour strength, maybe 3-day strength. So all these things in precast operations or pre-stressing operations, these things do matter. You need to take into account of these things also. Type of aggregate, whether using granite or basalt, wherein the properties of aggregates do change, specific gravity of aggregate do change, whether you are using a natural river sand, crushed stone sand, what is the maximum cement content allowed, what type of admixture you are using, all these things you need to take into account. Then, if you want to go by step-by-step procedure, I need not really go into the details. Still, I will go through fast because it's already there in IS 10262. You can see. So, for first and foremost step is to calculate the target mean strength for which we will be designing the concrete mix. Whatever the strength we achieve in our trials, during trials in the laboratory, the strength should be more than the target mean strength. And don't expect the target mean strength to be achieved inside conditions, because inside conditions everything will not be ideal. The strengths will not be equal to target mean strength, but definitely should be more than the characteristic strength of compressive strength of concrete. How much more? Again, there is acceptance criteria. FCK plus 3 simply we can say to be used. So this target mean strength is very important. You can refer, already discussed, you can refer to the standard deviation and other things. And selection of water cement ratio, keeping in mind the exposure condition wherein you can, you know the maximum water cement ratio which you can adopt for that particular exposure condition. And there, you will have to calculate the knowing the water content. Of course, we first of all we will go with the water content, and then go to the water cement ratio, and then check against the maximum water cement ratio allowed in the standard. So selection of water content is done using this particular table. Depending upon the size of the aggregate, 10, 20 or 40, the maximum water content is given. These are the maximum water content, not necessary that you should take this water only. This is the maximum water content allowed. Of course, the free total water is to whatever the water content you take. To thus, you have to add water absorption. If already some moisture is present in the fine aggregate, you will have to deduct the water. But whatever you take, this can be a starting point. You know this cement content, and you know the water content. And there are many corrections to be done for the water content. Or the water cement ratio based on the whether the aggregates are angular, gravel, rounded, what type of aggregate, because we always aim at 25 to 50 mm slump, this particular water content, and you have to increase about 3% for every additional 25 mm slump, because normally for pumpable mixes, we always aim for 100 plus or minus 20 mm slump, we can say. So, like this, you'll have to calculate the water cement ratio by choosing the cement content and then the water content. But while doing all these things, you should keep in mind that maximum cement content should not exceed 450 kg per cubic meter. Minimum cement content is inclusive of cementitious material, but maximum cement content, it can be plus maximum cement content plus cementitious materials. So it can be more than 450, but cement alone shall not exceed 450. So use of chemical water reducing admixture also to be taken into account. Whatever you use, if you are using ordinary plastics, nobody uses nowadays ordinary plasticizer, which only reduces water by about 5 to 10%. All super plasticizers reduce water at least 20%, or the hyper plasticizers reduce water by more than 25 to 30%. So taking into account of all these things, we will also calculate the coarse aggregate proportion by using this particular table for the volume of coarse aggregates per unit volume of aggregate for different zones of fine aggregate. So whether the sand, the fine aggregate you are using, falls into zone 2 or zone 3, based on that you will get the volume of coarse aggregate. And then it would be again based on the nominal size of the aggregate. Once you know the volume, you can proportion the coarse aggregate and fine aggregate separately. So this is, of course, as I told you, fine aggregate can be from crushed stone sand, CSS we call it as. So from a VSA crusher, we'll have a very consistent shape and size. So once you arrive at the mixed proportion, carry out the trial. If they are not achieving the required workability, make suitable modifications and carry out the trial number 2 by changing the cement content and water content. And then you will be able to achieve the required workability and the strength. Now, we'll go through fast one particular example of fly ash replacement for a M40 grade of concrete. The minimum cement content for this particular severe condition, because the exposure condition taken is severe. For severe exposure condition, it is 320 kg per cubic meter, and the maximum water cementation for severe is 0.45. Workability required is 120 mm. And these are the other requirements: what type of aggregate you are using, what type of chemical you are using, what type of cement you are using, specific gravity of cement, specific gravity of coarse aggregate, fine aggregate. All these things are becomes the data of materials for the mixed design. So you need to know the gradation of aggregates through sieve analysis, because you will be required to blend 20 mm 12.5 mm in a suitable proportion to achieve the IS 383 requirements. These are all normally done in every site in the laboratories. So whatever the sand zone is there, now knowing, having all this data, you calculate the target strength for the M40 grade of concrete. The target strength is 48.25 newton per mm square. And then based on the experience, let us adopt a water cement ratio of 0.36, which is less than 0.45 maximum allowed as per the as per IS 456 table. Then you take for 20 mm aggregate 186 kg maximum water content. Then for the increased slump, you need to add water because now we'll be having more water than 186. Even though 186 is more maximum water content, but to get higher slump, we add about 3% of water for every 25 mm increase in slump. But you get some water content. But anyway, for pumpable mixes, we invariably use super plasticizers. The super plasticizer can give different water reductions. Minimum of 20% it will give. Because if I take 23%, based on the trials, we have taken 23% as the minimum water content reduction. So thereby, the water comes down to 155 kg per cubic meter of concrete. So you know the water content, you know the cement content, then you know the water cement ratio 0.36, and you know the water content 155. 155 divided by 0.36 will give you 431 kg per cubic meter of cement. So from the table 5 of IS 456, the minimum cement content is 320. Now whatever the cement content we have got is 431, which is quite okay. So now you have to look into if you want to replace with any cementitious material. Normally the code suggests increase by about 10%. So thereby your total cementitious content become 474, then water content is 155, the actual water cement ratio becomes 0.327. And suppose if I select 30% replacement of fly ash, then you will get a replacement value of 142 kg per cubic meter fly ash and 322 cement content. So you can see From 474, you have come down to 322 of OPC and 142 of fly ash for a M40 grade of concrete. Now, once you fix the cement content and water cement ratio, then you have to select the coarse aggregate volume. And this coarse aggregate volume is selected by the table depending upon the zone of the sand, what you are using, zone 2 sand. In the present case, water cement ratio is 0.327. And there are some corrections even for this also. Those corrections can be applied. And finally, you can arrive at the volume of coarse aggregate content as 0.59. And from 0.59, 1 minus 0.59 will give you volume of, normally it will be like this only, about 60% of coarse aggregate and about 40% of fine aggregate. Unless it is self-compacting concrete, always coarse aggregate content will be higher and fine aggregate content will be lower. So for 1 cubic meter of concrete, now you can go on calculating the volume of each material by using specific gravity. So volume of each material, volume of cement first, and then that is 0.105, volume of fly ash. It's using its specific gravity, then volume of water, and then the volume of chemical admixture, you know its specific gravity also. Then volume of all-in aggregate will be 1 minus this much. Now, entrapped air is also taken into account. And finally, you can arrive at the mass of coarse aggregate and mass of fine aggregate by considering its specific gravity of 2.74 value. So once you know all these quantities, cement, fly ash, water, and fine aggregate, now you have your proportion, mixed proportion ready. And you know the batch quantities for cubic meter. You can do in the laboratory, normally 10 kg mix is done. If it is a site, it can be one bag mixer, or if it is a blatching plant, it can be 1 cubic meter at a time or 2 cubic meter at a time. Depending upon that, you can carry out the trials, actual trials. Trials carried out to check the required workability, compressive strength at different ages, and of course the durability, which we will come to discuss in the. So like fly ash, GGBS also can be, of course, I have not gone into the details of the slump obtained or the compressive strength obtained. So only to, just to give a steps involved, this example was taken. Similarly, in the same way, you can, by making use of the properties of GGBS, you can replace the GGBS with the cement content for the same properties of material for M40 grade of concrete. So you can see here a GGBS content of about 40% is replaced. Fly ash, as far as fly ash is concerned, for the cement manufacturing, 35% is maximum. But there is no such thing for the concrete. You can go beyond 35% also. Up to 50%, you can replace the fly ash. Coming to GGBS also, it's very common nowadays to use at least 40%. And wherever you want to exploit the benefit of GGBS, it should be at least 40 to 50%, especially in coastal areas where you want to have both chloride and sulfate resistant properties for the concrete. It is preferable to have at least 50% GGBS in the mix. For GGBS, up to 70% is allowed for the cement manufacturing, but for the concrete manufacturing also 50, 60, 70% has been used very comfortably. Concrete mixes have been designed comfortably. So like this, GGBS at 40% replacement, 172, and cement content is 215 for M40 grade of concrete. So in the same way, you can find out the proportions, the various aggregate cubic meter, and we can arrive at the mixed proportion for the trails. So like this, fly ash and GGBS are the most popular replacement, cement replacements which are used, which will definitely help from the durability point of view. Now, coming to durability of concrete, there are various tests which are there to determine the durability. Durability is a very general, generic term, very difficult to understand, follow, and also interpret the test results. Because whatever we do in the laboratory using small specimens, the same thing we want to see in the actual site conditions also. So various tests have been devised, and Indian standard is also bringing out the in IS 516 for the all hardened concrete properties. IS 516 revision is taking place. Some parts have been already released. For example, if you see this IS 516 part 2, section 1, it talks about water permeability test, and which is equal to DIN permeability, or there is an EN standard also, equivalent to EN standard. So now we have something, one particular test. Of course, there is a water permeability test earlier also, IS code is there, that determine the coefficient of permeability. But coefficient of permeability is a bit difficult to kind of understand. So from it is very easy to find out the depth of water penetration. To understand, it is easy to understand the depth of water penetration or water permeability. When you split the sample into two, after subjecting into a very high water pressure up to 5 bar, 4 bar or 5 bar. So then, because you know we don't want water to reach the reinforcement level. So with that idea, project to project, the specification changes. Sometimes the MORTH, Ministry of Road Transport, says the depth of water penetration shall not be more than 25 mm. That is one specification. Stringent, maybe like Metro Works, they specify should not be more than 15 mm. Similarly, some other project may be restricting it to 10 mm. Coastal areas projects of very national importance, they may restrict it to still 10 mm. So that means, you know, if you want to make the concrete as dense as possible, it is a mixed proportioning, it is a selection of the materials, it is the quality of the materials, it is the shape of the aggregates, it is a type of admixture you are using, as less water as possible by using a very efficient superplasticizer. These things do matter. If you want to restrict the water permeability, water penetration, or depth of water penetration to less than 10 mm, then this is the most popular test which is done everywhere. Most of the people have started introducing this test in the tender specifications and also project specifications. But still, it is not yet become very popular. But definitely, it is seeing, as there is a code now, IS 516 standard is also there. Now I think it will be included. And ISAT is one test which is done to know the surface characteristics or surface porosity of the concrete. Very, very fast 30 minutes test, which give you an idea of quality of the cover concrete. Then for coastal areas, we have a rapid chloride permeability test, RCPT, we call it as a RCPT test, or diffusion of chloride ions into the concrete. Electrical indication of the diffusion of the chloride ions into the concrete is what we measure in a 6-hour test. It's a 6-hour test, simple test, but you need to have that equipment, RCPT, especially very useful when you are making the concrete in coastal areas wherein the chloride exposure is there, concrete. Sorptivity is something which is capillary action in basements and all, when the water rises into the concrete from the bottom. Sorptivity gives an indication of the concrete quality, whether it can resist the capillary rise of water into the concrete. Then there is another test called water absorption test, which is a very simple half an hour test to know the how much water the concrete can absorb. Normally, water absorption test we do on materials like bricks, blocks, and things like that. For concrete, we do not have any Indian standard for this water absorption or sorptivity or RCPT or ISAT. But water absorption test is given in IBS 1881. There are no specifications for this. You can decide, or when you conduct various tests depending upon the grade of concrete or the mixed proportioning, you will get different values. It can be as high about 4% to 6% also, but definitely less than the concrete blocks. Concrete blocks have water, maximum water absorption is 10% for the concrete blocks, but we are talking about structural concrete. Structural concrete should absorb as less water as possible. It can be, it cannot be zero. It will be, there will be some values, water absorption will be there. So this is a good indication of how porous or how dense the concrete is. So this is what I was talking about, IS 516 part 2 section 1. Like this, there will be many more IS 516 standards are going to be released, which will include most of the durability tests also, if I'm correct. Oxygen permeability, carbonation, accelerated carbonation test. So these are all the tests which will be included in IS 516. So this is a water penetration test. We apply water bar, 5 bar water pressure for 3 days. And after 3 days of water pressure, we remove the cylinders or cubes. It can be done on concrete cubes also or cylinders also. They are split into two. And physically, the depth of water penetration is measured. It can be 5 mm, it can be 10 mm, it can be 15 mm. If the concrete is very porous, it can be more than 25, 30 mm also. So it's a very good indication of how dense the concrete is. This can be done as per the DIN method or IS 5162 method. So this is initial surface absorption test. So there will be a capillary tube. There's a measuring scale and a very small head of water which will go into the concrete and again rises from the other side, which gives water passing water through the surface only. It's a surface absorption test. The values really it's not very easy to understand. Many times, you know, it's since the 30 minutes test, we'll come to know whether the concrete is absorbing much of water or it's resisting the surface absorption. Then this particular apparatus is RCPT test using 100 mm dia samples and 50 mm thick samples. The chloride ions are passed through the samples and the current is passed. Know that charges, coulombs passed, C is equal to coulombs passed, C is equal to current into time. So we measure, we directly get the charges passed in coulombs from this test. It's a 6-hour test. You might get sometimes conflicting results, but normally this is a very good indication of the resistance to chloride. ASTM 1202 gives some indications if the values are more than 4000. Chloride ion permeability is considered as very high. 2000 to 4000 is moderate. 1000 to 2000 is low. And 100 to 1000 is very low. Less than 100 is negligible. So you can assess what type of concrete you have proportioned from the durability point of view by conducting this test and classifying the concrete as per this table. So whether it can really withstand the harsh coastal tidal waves or the chloride environment, this gives a very good indication. So we in our laboratory we do a lot of mixed designs for various grades of concrete, and then we do measure the work strengths at various ages and also the durability parameters. If whenever the customer asks, so these are some of the typical mixed designs starting from M10 to M45 or more than that by replacing GGBS at various percentages. Wherever required, we use silica fume also. These are the cement and GGBS replacements you can see. Of course, these are not very high replacements. Nowadays, it's almost become 50-50 if you are making a concrete of M20 grade. 150 plus 150 is also becoming very common, 150 cement and 150 GGBS. This is another M45 grade of concrete mixed design with 185 cement content and 275 GGBS, 60% GGBS and 40% cement. Then you know here the strengths are also quite good at 7 days. Stump is also at 2 hours, about 180 1 mm, and compressor strength at 28 is also satisfying all the requirements. On the same mix, we carried out the durability test, all these durability tests, water penetration, then it's about 12 mm. You can see average values also there. Rapid chloride permeability test, coulombs are also falling under low values. Then initial surface absorption is given in ml per square meter per second. That means the surface absorption is measured over an area, and the values are normally very small, 0.1, 0.2, like that. 0.1 ml per square meter per second is the absorption, and normally it ceases after about 30 minutes. There won't be any more absorption. If it is absorbing, the concrete is porous in nature. Then water absorption values are also quite low here. Normally you may not get this type of values, but the values can be 3%, 4%, like that also, up to that one. But this particular is particular results are showing a very, very low value of 0.4 of that order. So these are the durability tests which I want to discuss. And now I want to just finally would like to take you or explain this record which has come in 2017, 16700, criteria for structural safety of tall concrete buildings. The details of the design aspects or the seismic design or whatever the geometrical shapes and so many things, but I'm interested in only the concrete part of it. For the first time, the Indian code has addressed the need for the durability test in this code only. Even though IS 456, IS 10262 talks about durability indirectly, but this particular code has mentioned the tests and also the minimum grade of concrete in some cases, and also the specifications for RCPT, permeability, and things like that. You can see specifications for concrete in tall buildings. So these are the requirements. Minimum grade is M30 here for tall buildings, not M20 as we look into for normal RCC. So ranging grades ranging from M45 to M70 suggested. You can see when you cross M70 to M90, you need to be very carefully. You'll have to design the mixes. Expert concrete technology with specified values for the parameters and modulus of velocity, shrinkage, creep, durability. All these things have been included. It also says, considering the durability and sustainability, advantage of use of supplementary cementitious materials such as fly ash, GGBS, shall be permitted as part replacement of OPC, provided the permissible replacement limits are specified in relevant codes are not exceeded. So these are even 90 day strength is considered here, more than 28 days. You can see C there, A, B, C, D, E. So like this in C, 90 day strength is also can be taken into account. This is what it says. So this is what I was talking about, RCPT values for foundations, not more than 1,000 coulombs. Quite stringent here. You want to make the concretes, the RCPT should be less than 1,000. Superstructures, slightly higher values allowed, 1,500. And water penetration, maximum is 15 mm. And superstructure for foundation is 15 mm, superstructure is 20 mm. So effective steps shall be taken in the design of high strength concrete having low water cement ratios, for example, less than 0.3. So there is it gives an indication. You have to be very careful, don't exceed 0.3, then only you'll be able to achieve a durable concrete. So these are the things which are mentioned in this particular standard, IS 16700. So with this, I would like to finally tell in this hour of concern and also lockdown, be safe from coronavirus infection. Be smart and inform about it yourself. We should understand. We should understand first, then only we can tell others. Be kind and support one another. So I finally thank you all for your kind attention. Thank you very much.
pointed out by you, water penetration in terms of you know, whether it can be 10 mm, 20 mm, 25 mm. Sometimes you know, it is as low as 10 mm. That is what we have been able to achieve by various concrete trials using our cement at research center. So that was a very eye opener for all of us. Many tests with reference to IS 10262 was also mentioned in detail. Now coming to some of the questions, like there is a particular question that has been asked regarding the usage of cement, the heat of hydration. You know, whether heat of hydration is published or not in a test certificate. Now, one clarification that we would like to give is that yes, heat of hydration is not published in normal test certificate, but whenever it is required, we are giving it. Say, for example, for mass concreting work, as the questioner was rightly raising it, whether are you going to give heat of hydration values for mass concreting works? Yes, we do give. So you will have to ask for it. If you are using a cement for a particular special work, we will be very happy to share the data with you. But on a normal basis, heat of hydration is not mentioned in the cement test certificate. That is one thing. Second thing is that second question that they have been asking about cement is, would the type of cement change the mix design, you know, the mix design calculation? So your take on that, sir, would you like to take it?
Pardon, what is it one? What is the question?
Question is the type of cement, the type and quality of cement, would it change the mix design calculation? Because as you rightly were showing the graphs of cement and all that, no? Depending on the compressive strength, it will change. So would you like to throw more light on that?
Yeah. Whatever may be the type of cement, if you know the its 28 day strength, you can make those graphs and arrive at the water cement ratio for the compressive strength required.
So that indeed determines. And regarding pile concreting, there is one question which has been raised. Cement contained content as mentioned in IS 456, and the cement content for pile concrete. Pile concrete, they are saying it is 350 kg. Can it be treated as cementitious content for piling, or is it cement content alone? You know, is there a difference between what he is trying to do is that he is trying to compare pile concreting with the provision of IS 456. I think
pile concreting, of course, IS 456, that means, you know, for pile concreting, you should have minimum 350 kg. See, for mild, and mild it is 300 kg. For severe, for moderate also 300 kg. For severe it is 320. But for pile it is 350. It is cementitious content only. Cement is,
GG. So the answer to that is, sir, it is cementitious content only, 350 kg per cubic meter for pile concreting. So that is answered, and let us look at other. One more question which has been raised is, should we use any kind of hydrophobic material or anything which can make concrete, you know, impermeable? Is it really required, is the question.
Hydrophobic, that means an ingredient to the concrete. No, I don't. There is one hydrophobic cement is there. It's a very special cement. As far as concrete is concerned, the chemical admixtures also prevents the water coming in contact with cement particles for some time to maintain its workability. Apart from that, I don't think any hydrophobic material is considered.
I do agree with you on that, sir, because
maybe he's trying to say to avoid the water penetration, people provide some coatings. Proofing coatings.
That is only in special structures, maybe under basement or where there is a lot of water penetration possible. I think for such type of structures, maybe a special kind of waterproofing techniques may be required. So that was rightly answered. And another very basic question what has been asking is, what is the meaning of sorptivity? Because the one thing which you have mentioned in the durability test, sorptivity, I think, is nothing to do with capillary action, no? Something to do with capillary
action. It's capillary action only. In the basements, you know, water rises from the bottom. It's a simple test. The samples are kept in water. How much water has risen from the bottom through capillary action, that is determined. Sorptivity. That is sorptivity. It's a rise of water through capillary action.
True. Another very practical question they have raised is, how to convert design mix ratio to volumetric mix for M30 and above grade? Normally advised.
Volume mix is not normally advised, but still do not have any weighing batching facilities, you can make use of the density of materials to convert it into volume. The weight of each batch, weight of each material, make use of the density and convert it into volume. And then again, volume you'll have to either prepare the box of a suitable one cubic feet or something like that. And you have to do the volume batching.
I think rightly answered, because for higher grade of concrete, it is always advisable to go for way batching rather than go for volume batching. Another this thing is that another question is again the same relating to the previous question, because we do trials in the laboratory using weight basis, but at the site we are doing it volumetric basis. So there is a possibility of errors. Indeed, it is there.
Volume batching is not advised. Code at least doesn't allow nowadays for this, this thing. Volume batching, if at all, if it is very compulsory, I told you, you will have to convert and to be on the pause, you will have to add a little bit more cement and things like that you have to follow. Yeah. Control if you go for volume batching.
Another question relating to IS 9103, it is relating to water reduction percentage. You know, how to determine this water reduction percentage is the question that is raised.
See, you make a mix with normal water, let us say 0.55 water cement ratio, and achieve some slump, 40 mm or 50 mm slump, whatever slump you get with the mix without chemical admixture. Then you reduce by 20% water. Then add some dosage, or go on adding a dosage which will give the same slump as the control mix. When you get the same slump as the control mix, that gives the percentage of water reduction which you can achieve to achieve the control mix slump.
Very rightly, because we have also done that mixes with and without admixture to see the percentage of water reduction, a very practical test that can be done at site as well. Another question is, what is ultra high performance concrete? Is it being used anywhere in India?
High performance concrete is nothing but strengths more than 200 or 300, maybe almost going nearly equal to the tough steel strength. So ultra high performance concrete, you need to proportion the mixers by making use of fibers and so many other materials wherein the ductility of the concrete increases. Ductile is one trade name which has been and people have done ultra, but not much of, we have reached 200 MPa in Mumbai, I think, in one of the projects. 200 MPa was the maximum ultra high performance concrete used. So if the performance is exceeding your high performance concrete, that is called as ultra high performance concrete.
I think very rarely 200 MPa and above is used in very few projects in India. Very rightly answered, yes sir. And another very practical question that they have raised is, I found superplasticizer need not be used for all buildings. Only a few buildings need to use it because it's so costly for construction. That is another concern that has been raised. But of course, you know, we have seen that superplasticizer is used wherever it is required. I mean, it need not be used for normal site. Wherever you have transportation is there, or wherever special requirements in concrete is there, I think that is where superplasticizer will come into play.
You are pumping the concrete, superplasticizer is a must. Otherwise, you will not get a cohesive pumpable mix without superplasticizer. If it is a manual placing, you may not require superplasticizers, but pumpable mix all requires use of superplasticizers.
Another very practical question. We do trial mixes in the laboratory using baby mixture or that normal rotating mixture, and at the batching plant when we replicate the same thing, there are problems of stickiness in the concrete mix. So how do we resolve that?
As already I told you, the laboratory mixers, if it is a pan mixer, it is good. Otherwise, if it is a tilting type baby mixer, the efficiency of the mixing will be not as good as that you find in the batching plants, because I told you twin shaft blade mixers, their efficiency is very good. Sometimes we have seen the dosage of admixture even gets reduced at batching plants than what is proposed in the laboratory because of the efficiency of the mixer. So such modifications required to be done. You have to do that actually.
The answer is that we need to do both batching plant trials along with the laboratory trials. Generally, we will be able to get a better idea. That's a very practical way of looking at it. And the last, this is the last question, and with this, I think we should be winding up. The high-grade self-compacting concrete, it fails to achieve its characteristic strength after 28 days. Any reasons for that?
Self-compacting concrete.
High-grade, the self-compacting concrete, normally they say it's high-grade. So it fails to achieve its characteristic strength. That is what the question says, after 28 days. Any particular reason
for that? Has to be any data, it has to be a mix, it has to be revised. That's all. If it is not achieving the strength, you have to revise the no reason. If you are not getting at 7 days, at 28 days, you must be getting the strength because you are using either fly ash or GGBS in SCC, self-compacting concrete. Early strength may be less, but later strength has to be, it has to reach. If at all, if it is not reaching, you have to revise the mix.
So that was a very good interaction, and I think most of the questions has been taken. And thank you, sir, for that wonderful presentation. And we request all the construction professionals who have logged in to look at concrete from a durability perspective, because at the end of it, what is important is the life of the concrete structure. So along with workability and compressive strength, we also need to give durability its due. And for critical structures, we should also look at durability through various tests that has been mentioned. And in case you need any help, I think one needs to contact the experts. And we also have facilities at Ramco Research Development Center also for checking the durability of concrete. So there are facilities in India for checking the durability, and it can be made use of. So with those few words, I thank you, sir. And I thank all the construction professionals who have logged in. And let us meet tomorrow at 10:30 a.m. For a talk on modern construction practices by Dr. Shiv Shankar. And then in the evening tomorrow, we would be having a very interesting panel discussion on ready mix concrete. We would let you know once it is confirmed for tomorrow evening. Day after tomorrow, that is Sunday, we are again scheduling a talk on ferro cement and its application by Dr. Ganesh of NIT Calicut. So please, join us for the future webinars, and let us continue this interaction. And with those words, I thank the speaker, I thank the construction professionals, and thank you, sir. Thanks for joining us. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you.